Why is it that we never have a beer in our entire life that tastes as good as the beer that we have when we're 16 years old? There's something about illegal alcohol that just tastes better. And while tonight we may not solve the riddle to that age-old question of why that tastes better, we are going to learn all about how Kingston and Hudson Valley responded to that horribly misguided experiment, Prohibition. My name is Paul O'Neill, and on behalf of Kingston's Buried Treasures, I'd like to welcome everyone to our presentation in our monthly lecture series. And as you may have guessed, the subject tonight is bootlegging. And we're all familiar with the romantic tales of bootleggers and rum runners and mob bosses and flappers. And I think we could probably all envision ourselves slipping into some illicit speakeasy for a nip during the high times of Prohibition. But what Prohibition really did was it eroded public trust in the law. It eroded the trust in the established law, unlike anything since the Stamp Act during the Revolutionary Era. What Prohibition did was it made the common man and woman a criminal, a socially acceptable criminal, but a criminal nonetheless. It's one of the most unique periods in our country's history. And here in Kingston in the Hudson Valley, we worked just as hard as anyone in Chicago or New York City to violate the law. But we're very fortunate tonight to have as our featured presenter an extraordinary woman. And you don't have to take my word for it. She was actually named Woman of the Year by the Poughkeepsie branch of the American Association of University Women in 2005. And she's been designated a Woman of Distinction by the New York State Senate. She spent a lifetime in public service as an educator and an activist, and her personal papers are actually part of the John F. Kennedy Presidential Library, and they're there from her term as a member in the Kennedy Commission or Committee on Juvenile Delinquency. She's been involved in almost every public organization that you could think of, from the League of Women Voters to the United Way, to the Rotary Club. She's a member of the Dutchess County Historical Society, the Poughkeepsie Public Library. She was the head of the School of Adult Education at Marist College, and she even served for a time on the Poughkeepsie Town Board. So it is truly an honor and a privilege to be able to introduce our feature presenter this month, Eleanor Charwat.
Thank you all for having me. I don't know if it was the illegal booze that brought you here, but I'm glad to see so many people. I've given this talk many times, and every time I add more stories that I incorporate in my talk from the audience. So I really hope at the end you will give me your stories. Now, how did I get into this? I had no idea that there was bootlegging in the Hudson Valley. How many of you knew that was a big business here? Oh, well, a lot of you. Okay, well, you're more historical than I was. I really didn't know it. I thought bootleggers lived in the mountains of West Virginia or Kentucky. Speakeasies were clubs in Chicago or New York City. But I thought, I grew up in Poughkeepsie. I know the Hudson Valley. I had no idea. It wasn't until I started writing a book about my father, whose name was Nathaniel Rubin, who was a lawyer in Poughkeepsie for 58 years. And after he died, I found his scrapbooks. And there was one case that really intrigued me. In the 30s, when he was the Depression, there weren't many private clients, he was designated to investigate the Dutchess County Sheriff's Office, who at that time had 187 deputy sheriffs, even though only 35 had been authorized in the budget. That was just one example. There were no audits, there was no approvals for spending, it was a mess. So he was part of a team that was looking at the sheriff's office. And in the middle of his investigation, the US attorney said, "Could you hold off for a while? We're in the middle of a big bootlegging case that involves the Dutchess County Sheriff's Office." So that's how I first heard anything about bootleggers. This was after Prohibition had ended, but it was still going on. So I went to the Adrian's Library in Poughkeepsie and went through those awful microfiche machines from the 20s and 30s, all the newspapers, and I had a woman volunteer help me, because nobody really wrote, you know, my mother was a bootlegger, you know. There's nothing written, so I had to take it from raids and different stories in the paper. I also read some books. There was a great one called Dry Manhattan about Prohibition in New York City that's mentioned a little bit about the Hudson Valley, but there wasn't a whole lot written. But that's how I got involved. And then I learned that this was actually called the Bootleg Trail from Canada to New York City. The booze came down on both sides of the river, and I'll tell you how and who and everything. But this was part of the Bootleg Trail. And we had big city gangsters here too. Many of you probably know Dutch Schultz and Legs Diamond, two New York City gangsters I'll talk about in a few minutes, who were right in the Hudson Valley feuding right here. So that was how I got involved. So what was Prohibition? Oops, yeah. Well, that's the next one. It was the 18th Amendment to the Constitution. It blew my mind when I realized it was passed even before women got the vote, which was the next year. But in 1919, thanks mostly to the Anti-Saloon League, the Women's Temperance Union, and churches who were appalled at the amount of drunkenness in the country, the fact that many men were spending their paychecks in bars, many women and children were left destitute. So their intentions were good. But as we can see, things don't always work out the way you intend. So they passed an amendment that prohibited the manufacture and sale of all intoxicating drinks. Most people who liked this idea were called the dries. Those that didn't like it were called the wets. And the prohibition opponents, or the wets, sang songs, and I found this in my dad's old sheet music, "Every day will be Sunday when the town goes dry." And they lamented the end of fun and cheer. I can't sing very well, but I want to tell you the words of the song. They're really funny. Mr. Prohibition says, John Barley Corn must go. He must fly off with Old Crow and the other brands we know. Old John has been champion for years beyond a doubt, but now it looks as they'll count him out. Soon, cloves and sensen will be out of date. When prohibition comes, they'll get the gate. Now this is the chorus. Goodbye, Hunter, so long, Scotch, farewell, Hague and Hague. Oh, my darling old frap, they will soon take you away. At the table d'hote with Lola, they will serve us Coca-Cola. No more saying, let me buy. No more coming through the rye. Old Manhattan and Martini have received the big subpoena. Every day will be Sunday when the town goes dry. And there are other choruses, but I thought that was cute. But sin was not eliminated. In fact, prohibition spawned a whole new industry to bypass the law in manufacturing, distributing, and selling illegal liquor. One observer said, it seemed as if the whole country had suddenly become involved in larceny. The Hudson Valley was no exception. Thousands of formerly law-abiding people began making their own liquor. And what do you think in the Hudson Valley they made it from? Apples, applejack, hard cider, grapes, wine, corn, bourbon, everything, actually. So from fruits and grains. Okay, Let me just see. The next one. The name moonshine, they think, came because it was made at night by the shine of the moon to avoid detection. And there were actually other songs during Prohibition that was the moon shines on the moonshine. Sugarfoot Stomp, Bootlegger Blues, and Minnie the Moocher. Remember Mountain Dew? Oh, they call it that old Mountain Dew, and them that refuse it are few. I'll hush up my mug if you'll fill up my jug with that good old Mountain Dew. So there was a whole, songwriters were a whole other group that profited from Prohibition. So other names for a bootlegging liquor were White Lightning, Mountain Dew, Hooch, Kickapoo Joy Juice, and Panther's Breath. There were a few others that were a little off color, and I didn't include those. there were cartoons like this one. I could never vote for someone who's never had to make his own liquor. Another joke at the time went, my Uncle Henry is allergic to moonshine. Whenever he drinks it, he breaks out in handcuffs. Stills to make illegal liquor operated in farms, restaurants, and homes all over the Hudson Valley. So just as I mentioned, these are some of the things they're made from. To make it, you need the raw ingredient of fruit or grains. You mix it with water and yeast, malt, or sugar. And the process is basically fermentation and distillation. And that the distillation is done in a still. The stills could be made out of anything, usually copper-lined ones, but sometimes they used things made lined with lead. And what do you think happened to people who drank that? Some of them died, some of them got very ill. So you had to know not only who was making the liquor, but what it was made in. Okay, let's see. And this was an example of a still. Some people say they still find stills in the woods around here that you can see. So the stills operated in farms, restaurants, and homes all over the Hudson Valley for local residents as well as consumers from New York to Canada. The bootleg trail was marked with splotches of yellow paint. Rum runners were paid $3 a case of liquor if they used the route. One winter, a car laden with liquor broke through the ice of Lake Champlain and sank in 40 feet of water. Imagine the party the fish had that day. Okay, that one idea of how bootlegger came, the term, they thought it was from 1733 when Governor George Oglethorpe from Georgia banned alcohol in his state and lawbreakers hid their bottles in their boots. Broadway impresario Billy Rose defined a bootlegger as a guy all dressed up who needs, quote, a place to glow. Raids in Dutchess County by local, state, and federal officials were common and were often based on tips from the New York Civic League, which was headed by Minister Harry Fisher and his volunteers. So they would tip off law enforcement if they knew people were making liquor or selling it. And these were some of the raids that were in the newspapers. When police raided a large rum plant, so they made rum also, over a restaurant at 65 South Clover Street in Poughkeepsie in 1926, they found a 500-gallon still in full operation in one of the largest businesses in the local history of Prohibition. A few days later, they found a 5-gallon jug of whiskey under the floor of Charlie Cuba's chicken coop and a 10-gallon keg of bootleg liquor under the woodshed at 174 North Water Street. 4 days later, 35 federal agents, quote, in a frantic attempt to stop a gigantic flow of liquor into New York City, raided the Lee Husted farm in Stanfordville that housed a still with a 1,200-gallon capacity to make good-quality alcohol from sugar. Yeah, the ingredients, again, you needed a lot of sugar. They also raided the Dillon House in Beacon, farms in Philmont, Plattekill, Highland, and Columbia County. The Bogardus farm in Dutchess County had a still running on cider to make Applejack. A farm on New Hackensack Road in LaGrange was raided for making rum. But many farmers survived the Depression by making this bootleg liquor. I'd had people tell me, you know, without it, they wouldn't have made it. On October 17th, in one of the biggest raids, 1932, federal agents raided Patrick Ryan's Harvest Homestead Farm on Route 82 in Pine Plains and uncovered the largest distilled liquor operation ever found in Dutchess County. And I'm just going to have water. This farm was what they found: two high-pressure boilers, two 2,000-gallon stills, 13 1,000-gallon vats of mash, 10,000 pounds of sugar, two 500-gallon tanks, two Ford trucks, one Rio truck, and a Lincoln sedan. The plant was located under the brow of a hill and consisted of a massive underground bunker and a sprawling network of interconnected tunnels. It is believed that Dutch Schultz, the beer baron of the Bronx, was the mastermind and financier of the operation. Oops. There's Dutch Schultz. One of his lieutenants was often seen around town in a black limousine with four bodyguards. This is Pine Plains. The bunker and tunnels still exist and will be on view this fall when the new Dutchess Spirits distillery opens. And that's where I got this sugar wash moonshine. I actually got to take a tour of Dutch Schultz's old distillery there, and you could see, I have some photos of the tunnels and the caves there. This whole thing is going to open to the public. They're going to have a restaurant, a catering hall, a gift shop on October 3rd this year. And I've been asked to speak at the Pine Plains Library October 2nd to kick it off. So they gave me an empty bottle of the stuff. But they are making things. They're making a nice peach brandy now. And they do have a legal license now in New York State. So it's the grandson of one of the workers who worked in this distillery, who, with a partner, is opening Dutchess Spirits. So that's called recycling here. So what happened to these guys? The bunker, yeah, okay. Local businesses remember that Mr. Ryan always paid in cash with $100 bills. Ryan was fined but never served time for bootlegging. He returned to Pine Plains and went into poultry farming for 4 or 5 years and then has disappeared. And the people at that distillery are trying to find out what happened to the Ryans. Dutch Schultz himself, well, let me tell you about him for a minute. Oh, goes too fast. He was actually born in Yorkville in New York City. He was a leader of a Jewish gang. Before Prohibition, he was just in numbers, rackets, extortion, prostitution, the usual. The usual there. There were three big gangs at the time in New York. The Jewish gangs headed by Schultz, the Irish gang headed by Legs Diamond, and the Italian gangs with Lucky Luciano and some of the others. And they were always fighting and shooting each other in New York. So to get away from some of the gang warfare in New York, they came to the Hudson Valley. And Legs Diamond sort of set up in Albany, but came down as far as Kingston, as far as I know. And Schultz was more on our side of the river, but he did come over on this side too. So Dutch Schultz was murdered in Newark, at a Newark restaurant, and Lucky Luciano took over his territory. He was brought up on tax evasion charges, but I don't think he ever served time. and his arch rival, Legs Diamond. If any of you read the Kennedy book called Legs, William Kennedy, the author, he came up here too. His name, real name was Jack Diamond. He was the leader of an Irish gang, and he moved to the Catskills and was involved in a lot of shootouts. He was actually shot 3 or 4 times before he was killed. I mean, he just walked around with all these bullets in him. And he fled upstate where he said, I have a future, I got a future in the Catskills. And then in William Kennedy's book, Legs, about Legs Diamond, the narrator noted that Rip Van Winkle probably would have been hustling Applejack instead of sleeping it off if he'd been alive during Prohibition. So who knows? But Legs Diamond, and you may know more about this than I, took over the Barman Brewery in Kingston and distributed that product in Albany and New York City. In a raid on the brewery in Kingston in June 1931, federal agents found so much cash, weaponry, brewing equipment, trucking equipment, and beer that the raid became known as the $1 million seizure. They also discovered how Diamond had eluded capture for so long. The brewery ran a rubber hose through the Kingston sewer lines to warehouses a half mile away where it was bottled and trucked. Also, a system of tunnels and caves hid the beer and probably bodies as well. And one man after one of my talks said it was rumored that some of the Kingston fire departments donated those hoses. I have not verified that. He also told me if you allowed a tap for these sewer lines in your basement, you were allowed to take some of the beer yourself. So I can verify it, but if any of you have stories like that, I would appreciate it. So shortly after he was acquitted of kidnapping up in Troy, Legs Diamond was shot dead at his boarding house in Albany. No one is sure who pulled the trigger, the police, political bosses, or rival gangsters. So both of our local gangsters, who lived here anyway, were killed. Anyway, just one more thing. Okay, it was these New York gangsters who paid Dutchess County farmers to make and store whiskey. They basically rented their barns, usually. They had signals to warn if there was a raid coming. They would say, get the cows out if the raid was going to be on a farm in Millbrook, or get the sheep out if it was to be in Rhinebeck. The Stanford Town Justice selected the sites for the stills, and the head of the Dutchess County Jail received bribes from the gangsters to look the other way. In 1939, this was the case I mentioned that my dad had, in Dutchess County, local internal revenue agents, deputy sheriffs, and town officials were implicated in a federal investigation of New York City gangsters. The U.S. attorney accused 31 defendants of conducting a vast moonshine still operation in Dutchess County. And why do you think they really cared? Why did the government care? This is after Prohibition. What? Taxes. Defrauded the government of more than $2.5 million in liquor taxes. At least 3 of these defendants were connected with the Dutchess County Sheriff's Office. The names of the defendants come right out of a book by Damon Runyon. George Middleman was the ringleader. He was also known as Gush, Squint, or Squint. He threatened to, quote, take for a ride any witnesses in the case. Other characters were Dynamite Dan, Tommy the Fireman, that's a raid? No. Mickey the Mouse and Monkey Face. These were some of the guys that were written up in the paper. Frank Castellano, one of the gang, claimed to have paid Henry Wicker, the head of the Dutchess County Jail and chair of the Hyde Park Republican Party, $100 to $200 a week in hush money outside a Poughkeepsie drugstore. Wicker was found guilty and sentenced to a year and a day in the Lewisburg Federal Penitentiary by Judge Vincent Libel, the father of former state senator Vincent Libel. The judge warned, who also went to jail, but that's, I'm sorry. Anyway, that's another story. The judge warned Dutchess County farmers to regard with suspicion the renting of barns by strangers and to view such overtures as, quote, the arrival of smallpox, end quote. Okay, so we have all these farmers renting out their barns to gangsters, making the liquor from their produce. How do you distribute all this liquor? Well, first the law enforcement had to figure out how to get rid of the stuff they confiscated. How could they do it? Oh no. Dutchess County Deputy Sheriff spilled 1,100 gallons of confiscated bootleg applejack and wine into the sewer in front of the courthouse in October 1926 to the accompaniment of dirges sung while they worked. One deputy commented, if the liquor tasted anything like it smelled, it was fit only for the sewer. At another disposal of 1,000 gallons of applejack in the courthouse basement in 1930, at that time prisoners were in the county jail on the top floor of the courthouse. So they hung out of the windows, tilted their noses as the liquor fumes drifted up, and called out their orders to the deputy sheriffs down below. There are great stories in the paper, it's all in the newspaper. In 1922, City of Poughkeepsie First Ward residents objected to 700 bottles of bootleggers whiskey being destroyed at their dump on Delafield Street. Alderman Case complained that if there's something good to give away, the 7th Ward gets it. And when there's something nobody wants, we get it. So there's still same kind of ward fights going on, right? So how were they distributed? They were distributed in every way you can imagine. In the false bottoms of fishing boats, in the washrooms of trains, underneath the straw in horse wagons, in so-called tanker cars whose back seats and trunks were converted to single tanks, which could hold as much as 250 gallons of moonshine. Small airplanes, and even in mail trucks. This story didn't happen here, but I love it. In the South, when some mail carriers saw the flags on the mailboxes were up, they knew the owner wanted another batch of liquor, and the money was inside the box. When one carrier was stopped by a U.S. Marshal, he sputtered, "You can't stop the U.S. mail." Most of the lucrative business at the Red Oaks Mill Airport, which is now the Dutchess County Airport, was the repair of bootleggers' planes, which experienced much wear from the frequent trips across the Canadian border, said Poughkeepsie's Albert Gurney in a recent article in the Poughkeepsie Journal. People spoke of my bootlegger the way they spoke of my doctor or my barber. Everybody had their own bootlegger. Some of the early stock car races in the South gained their skills as moonshine transporters driving like daredevils on mountain roads to avoid the government agents. In upstate New York, young men who were out of the Army after World War I and without jobs found a quick way to get rich by driving bootleg liquor in their own cars or in cars stolen in a ring that was centered in Albany. During the first year of Prohibition alone, 1921, $10 million in liquor, 800 autos, and 13,000 stills were seized in New England and New York alone, and 10,000 people were arrested. Law enforcement was overwhelmed, undermanned, and ill-equipped to deal with so many lawbreakers. Sorry, another drink. So we talked about how bootleg liquor was made, how it was distributed, where was it sold? It was mostly sold in speakeasies where one had to speak a password to enter, or in private clubs, or individually. Prohibition didn't hurt Poughkeepsie much, said Dennis Cooper, former owner of River Station. There were hundreds of speakeasies operating in the city, including one where River Station now stands. That's down near the river at the foot of Main Street. It was called the Myers Clam Tavern. The saloon was downstairs, a bordello upstairs. Dayliner passengers from New York came up to have fun in Poughkeepsie, he said. And I found this great map of Poughkeepsie. Speakeasies, that's Main Street, every street, and that on the top, I don't have my pointer, top right corner is a courthouse, and right across Market Street was the speakeasy where the lawyers went after they were in court. It's now called Alex's Restaurant. Other speakeasies were Zeph's in Hyde Park, which is now Gaffney's Pub, the Village Inn in Verbank, and the Black Swan in Rifton, which was controlled by Dutch Schultz. Bless you. Newspapers in the 1920s were filled with accounts of raids on speakeasies. One of the biggest was in 1926 on 13 locations, all on Main Street in Poughkeepsie. The only permitted beverages were for religious or medicinal purposes. Guess how many people found God or got sick? Or both. The Brotherhood Winery in Washingtonville, America's largest continuously operating winery, stayed in business during Prohibition by providing government-sanctioned altar and medicinal wines. Drugstores did record businesses catering to the many sick people who were prescribed medicine. They would fill their prescriptions in the front of the drugstore and then come around to the back door to get their bootleg liquor. I actually had a woman whose father had one of those drugstores, and she remembers that, people coming around to the back door. During the late 1920s, though, many people saw that Prohibition was not working and called for its repeal. Dr. Frank Crane, minister of the First Baptist Church, warned that if the 18th Amendment were repealed, it would be, quote, after we renounce the Declaration of Independence, the Constitution, and ask Great Britain to take us back as a colony. Ending Prohibition became a major political issue in the presidential election of 1932. Democratic candidate Franklin Roosevelt waffled on the issue until fellow Democrat and New York political power Al Smith threatened to walk out of the National Convention unless FDR supported the repeal of the 18th Amendment. At the last minute, FDR came out against Prohibition and made its repeal a major campaign promise. After he was elected, one of his first actions wasn't taking care of the banks or unemployment, it was to allow the sale of wine and beer, which were important industries in New York City and New York State. Even while the constitutional amendment repealing Prohibition was making its rounds of the states, that was his very first act as president. Ironically, on December 6, 1933, Utah became the 36th and deciding state to ratify the 21st Amendment ending Prohibition. The day before that, the Poughkeepsie police chief warned prospective repeal revelers that, quote, he would pursue a course of relentless prosecution of drunkards who abuse their regained privilege of legalized drinking. And this cartoon appeared in the paper. I don't know if you can read it. I can't see it from here. Balfill just observes the plain rules of the road, and it says adherence to the liquor laws at Poughkeepsie Bridge. Despite his warning, revelers began slaking their 13-year thirst for legal beverages after the first shipment of domestic liquor was rushed into Poughkeepsie by David Clarkson, a New York and Newburgh wholesaler. The truck first stopped at Fritz Sanger's Inn on South Road, then went to the Elks Club, the Moose Club, and the Hotel Campbell. Retail liquor stores, which were granted the first licenses, were on Market Street and Academy Street in Poughkeepsie. But no sooner had the legal liquor tickled the tongues of local people than they started to complain about the taste and the high cost. They didn't like the blended or cut whiskey as well as the old throat-tingling kind they got from bootleggers. Legal gin jumped from 50 cents a bottle to $2.50 to their dismay. And the writer H.L. Mencken celebrated the end of Prohibition by drinking a tumbler of cold water, his first in 12 years. Well, I'll have some more of that too. So what were the effects of Prohibition? Paul mentioned some of them. Basically, it pitted the government against individual rights and liberties, rural against urban populations, native-born Americans against immigrants, and made the United States wary of passing laws to regulate morality. Prohibition actually increased the demand for liquor and made many formerly law-abiding citizens into criminals and hypocrites. People who had never had the slightest interest in drinking liquor, never mind making it, now sought recipes from friends, neighbors, and the public library. One man I know found in the rafters of his basement written a recipe for making bootleg liquor. Women who had seldom frequented bars or taverns before enjoyed the shiver of excitement at being admitted to speakeasies and private clubs. Young people frequented dance halls where they engaged in excessive drinking of each other's brand of hooch. The sheriff set up a campaign against these whoopee makers to stop the accidents caused by young people driving while intoxicated. The hip flask became a status symbol for boys hardly old enough to shave. Some students paid their way through college making and selling intoxicants to their classmates. Corruption increased, as I mentioned. Many politicians, police, lawyers, and judges were on the take from organized crime racketeers involved in the illegal trade of liquor. Jurors were paid off, and witnesses developed what they called Chicago amnesia when called to testify against mobsters. The federal government lost billions of dollars in tax revenues from liquor, so other taxes had to be raised to make up for the lost revenue, which was very difficult during the Depression. Crime increased as rival gangs vied for the lucrative liquor business. Shootings, hijackings, street murders, gang wars, and the formation of organized crime and networks all resulted from Prohibition. It seemed that Dutchess County and Ulster County reflected the rest of the country in its defiance of Prohibition. But that era has not died. Many of you may have seen Ken Burns' three-part documentary called Prohibition that he made for PBS. HBO, I think, is still running Boardwalk Empire. That takes place during Prohibition. And when my husband and I were not so long ago in Panama, in the Panama Canal, we found out that Al Capone's boat, that was used to smuggle bootleg liquor from Canada to the U.S. is now in use as a ferry on the Panama Canal. And as I mentioned, Dutch Schultz's old farm in Pine Plains is now listed on the New York State Archaeological Inventory as, quote, a bootleg era bunker complex. And it's now known as Dutch's Spirits and will be opening in October. Their motto is drink with conviction. And Dutchess County residents still run across rusty stills and other moonshine apparatus in woods or barns or basement. And I know this group is called Buried Treasure, and you probably heard that there's still rumored to be anywhere from $6 to $10 million of Dutch Schultz's money in a tin box somewhere around Phoenicia or somewhere in Ulster County, maybe in Pine Plains. Treasure hunters have been looking for it for years, but they haven't found it. So it's still open for you all. So thank you all, and I appreciate.
Ellie really has a great idea, because what other subject can you speak about where you can actually show up and drink the entire time, and it's actually expected and encouraged? So I've got to change what I'm talking about. Ellie, that was wonderful. That was absolutely wonderful. Do we have any questions?
I'd love to hear any of your stories.
Or any stories, yes.
Yeah. I had one lady tell me, this was in New York, but her mother was a widow trying to raise kids in the Depression. There was no welfare, no Social Security. She had the luxury of having two bathrooms. And the mob came and said, we'd like to rent one of them and make bathtub gin. And that's how she survived. Another lady told me also she was a sole, her grandmother or somebody was a sole supporter of the family. And she drove a taxi cab from New Jersey up along the Hudson to pick up the liquor and bring it back to New York. So it was an economic boon for some people. So any other stories, I will incorporate them in my talk.
Any questions? Comments?
Yes.
When I was in kindergarten, we had a girl in there who's left on a vacation to go to Florida. This was 1937. Her father had just gotten out of prison from bootlegging, and they took a Florida vacation. Sent us a case of oranges for bootlegging, and her father could not ever be in the liquor industry after he was released from prison, but his whole family was, in fact, they're still in the alcohol business
around here.
Yeah. Beer, you know, the big beer distributors in the northern part of New York. Yeah, that's it goes back, but we didn't know why she left on vacation, but we found out afterwards.
And actually, one of the most popular shows on TV now is Moonshiners. I watch it; it's unbelievable. I think it's in West Virginia, and it's still going on. And now I'm sure these guys are making more money off the T-shirts they're selling than the booze. But
were there any stories of fires, especially if it's going to be made indoors, because it's very, you know, alcohol as it's burning is very volatile.
Yeah, I'm sure there were. I didn't read any around here, but I'm sure there were fires.
I have a story. House in Kingston on the corner of Wilbur and Greenkill. My grandmother used to tell me that actually my great grandparents built that house, and down in the basement, my grandmother, they had a front as a candy store, and she had 12 brothers and sisters, and they would take turns being able to work the candy store, and they would come in and ask for a certain type of candy, and she would go down in the basement and get the candy and bring it up. So they each one of the siblings got a turn, and they got like an extra nickel when they got to bring the candy upstairs. So the house is, again, if anybody would want to see it, it's on the corner of Wilbur and Greenkill. And my great-grandmother and great-grandfather made the blocks and everything and built the house, and had a connection to some Italian families in the city.
For years, I've heard rumors that Judge Crater was buried somewhere in the grounds of the Barman Brewery. Any truth to that?
Oh, don't ask me. I don't know.
For those of you who haven't heard, the Judge Crater disappearance was one of the great unsolved mysteries of the time.
Yeah.
And I hadn't heard that, but that's wonderful. Maybe we'll find him. Not wonderful that he disappeared, but what a feather in our cap, in a way.
Back in the 60s, I worked for John Arborio when they were building 299 in Highland. I was on the rough out crew. We went ahead and trees, stone walls, everything. We just moved it. One afternoon, we came upon this door in the side of the mountain. Didn't give it much thought. And then one of the guys went and hit it with the corner of the blade and busted it down. There was probably 400 cases of bootlegged liquor in there from Prohibition.
No kidding.
And most of it, unfortunately, but a lot of it, they had laid the bottles on their sides and the corks didn't rot out. And we had quite a field day with that stuff. And it was very good too.
Was there a question up here?
My father was a baker in New York City in Astoria. And the bakeries got sugar.
And yeast.
They had it all, and they would mix up all the danishes and everything, and that sugar would ferment. And when they cooked it, when they baked it, they had some kind of a gadget that they put in a chimney, and they extracted the alcohol out. And everything worked fine for a long time until the bakery caught on fire. All the firemen came and everybody got drunk, and that was the end of it.
That's great. These are great stories.
See, we keep contributing.
Yeah, okay.
When I was a kid in the 1920s, we lived on a farm in Highland, and we grew lots of Concord grapes. And one day my father said to me, "We're going to take a ride to Poughkeepsie. You want to go?" So we hitched up the two horses to the wagon, loaded it up with grapes. He took all the back roads. He wouldn't want to go on the main road at all to call attention to what he had in the back. And so we went down, crossed the ferry, went over and sold the grapes to some family over there, apparently in that den of iniquity, to make wine out of. So,
great.
So anyone have any other questions? You know, it's really amazing. There's, I'm sure many of you have read, there's a History of Ulster County by Alphonse Clearwater. And it's a two volume set. One is the actual history of the Ulster County, and the second is a couple hundred biographies of individuals who were prominent in the area around the turn of the century. And they tell a little bit about them, and then they tell some of the groups that they're in and organizations that they partake in. And I'm gonna say at least a third, easily a third and closer to a half of the people are involved in temperance societies. So it was really, you know, it's hard to fathom now. Do you know how hard it is to make a constitutional amendment? It is almost impossible. And they were able to do it to outlaw alcohol. There was a very vocal and prominent force that worked on this, and it really did blow up. I don't think we'd ever consider doing it again. And when you think about the early stockade, I mean, the first division of the stockade here in Kingston was 16 lots. I think three of those lots were distilleries and or breweries. So, I mean, it's been a huge part of our community from the very beginning. And think of Kingston today, uptown, downtown, midtown, if there were no bars. No restaurant that had any bars. I'll tell you, years ago, we did a pub crawl in Uptown only. I think there were 13 bars. We had planned to go all the way to downtown, but it ended up being 140 bars or something. It was unbelievable. Imagine what our community would be like if there was no alcohol. And you wonder what it was at the time, but I'd heard the stories about the tubes coming through, and that I didn't know about that with the firemen. And again, firemen are giving people. They help us. They helped us then, they help us now. And it is amazing to think that, you know, Dutch Schultz and Legs Diamond were huge figures. Huge figures. In fact, one of the reasons why Dutch Schultz was killed was because he was being relentlessly prosecuted by Thomas Dewey at the time.
Yeah.
He eventually got to a point where he said, I'm going to kill Thomas Dewey. Lucky Luciano said, you're absolutely not going to do that. The heat that that's going to bring down on all of us mm-hmm. is indescribable. Dutch Schultz was hot-headed and he was crazy. He said, I'm going to do it. You know, I don't care what you say. And that was one of the reasons that he was killed. Unfortunately for Lucky Luciano, once Thomas Dewey didn't have Dutch Schultz to go after, he started going after Lucky Luciano, and he did convict him, and he was put in jail for a while. He got a significant sentence, and then he actually helped during World War II. He helped with the Longshoremen's Union on keeping the docks free from any potential Nazi influence, and he was rewarded by being released from jail, but he was immediately deported to Naples and actually lived the rest of his life there and died in the Naples airport waiting for someone who was flying in to do his biography. And the story always has been that the mafia was never going to let Lucky Luciano tell his story. So it is an incredible story that we've had here. And Ellie, thank you so much. Thank you so much.
I did bring a few copies of my dad's book about some of his big cases. He had some really big murder cases around here. If any of you are interested, it's 1295. This Prohibition thing is just one little chapter in it, but if any of you want that. The other thing, somebody did tell me that Schultz and Diamond came to blows in Kingston, because Diamond had Albany South territory and Schultz was New York North. And Kingston, the gangs were split. And this man, I'm sorry I didn't get his name, said, I think it was his grandfather, was actually shot by the rival gang that he wasn't in. He wasn't killed, but he was shot. So there were shootings in Kingston between those two gangs that came to blows right here because they were on each other's turf. So if any of you have more information, or if that gentleman is here today, I'd like to talk to him more. Thank you,
Ellie. Thank you. And Ellie will have her books up here, so please come on up and get one. Again, we always want to take the opportunity to thank the people that make this series possible. We don't go through the names anymore because there were too many. And again, this is a community effort. I do want to, Bob Rizzo does an unbelievable job recording those. The people who watch upstairs get to see live the benefit of his work, but anyone who wants any a DVD for this presentation or any of the past ones, you can get in touch with Bob. He can get those for you. But we do want to, and we also, especially this time, we want to thank JK Wine and Liquor, our unofficial sponsor, and this is perfect. I did ask them if they had some moonshine, and I think they thought I was joking. I wasn't, but we do thank them and everybody who makes this possible. We want to let everybody know, again, we did run out of flyers tonight, but next month, June 19th, we're going to have, the presentation is going to be the DeWitt Mills and the Sign of the Crocodile. I don't know if you've heard the story of this, and I don't want to let the cat out of the bag, but it's probably the most interesting story that you're going to hear in Ulster County. It's really, and it ties into history. I'm going to keep you guessing, so we hope you come here for it. But there was a sign on the DeWitt Tavern. It was run by Garrett DeWitt, who was a son of Charles DeWitt, who was probably second only to George Clinton in prominence during the Revolutionary era. And there was a sign there that was found. The circumstances of how it was found, how it was sold, and where it is now are really an incredible story. So that's going to be next month. And then July 17th, Hayes Clement is going to be telling us about the courts. And most of you have heard, or if you haven't seen, you have to go down and see the courts mansion. It's one of the most beautiful buildings anywhere around. But they were brick makers in Kingston. So he is going to be telling us about the courts family and the brick industry. I do want to tell anybody, if you are, the Senate House does so much. They are such a huge part of this series being what it is. They give so much, and they do so much wonderful things in the community. And tomorrow, they are having an event. It's the preparing for New Year's. It's an 18th century spying and garden tour. It's going fair, I apologize. It's going to be wonderful, so if you're able to come, we'd ask that you come on in. I'm sure, I guarantee you will not regret it. And one thing before we leave, we do want to say congratulations to our own Hugh Reynolds and Phyllis McCabe. If you're not aware, Hugh Reynolds has, I always make a point to thank Hugh, because Hugh was, this is the first lecture that Hugh has missed from the beginning. There are very few people, in fact, I think the only two left are me and Ed Ford, that have made all of them. But Hugh was here for the first one as well, and he always does a wonderful story about the series. In fact, he helped push the series before we really were a series. But he could not be here today because he's getting married tomorrow to Phyllis McCabe. So we do want to take the opportunity to thank both of them and wish them well. So again, have a wonderful weekend. We hope to see you next month. And again, Ellie, thank you so much. She will have books up here.